Yo guys, Jonathan here, and the iMac Pro is here, like, now. And I'm not gonna lie, I'm a little excited. So first things first, we got that box within a box. Clearly, I've opened up one too many Amazon boxes where you don't need a knife. You know exactly what I'm talking about. With this one, I probably should have used one. So get into the first box. The excitement level just went from here to here, seeing that space for iMac Pro right smack on the front of the box. So iMac Pro is stamped on the top of the box, and on one side we see that beautiful 5K display, but as we flip things, there's a side profile shot of the iMac Pro, and because of that space gray, it looks like this shadowy silhouette, which is kind of awesome. Now before we can get to the iMac Pro, first we gotta get to those sweet, sweet space gray accessories. First is the Apple Wireless Keyboard with number pad, and those black keys paired with that space gray finish looks really good. Next is the Apple Magic Mouse, and as much as I love that space gray finish, not sure exactly how much I'll be using this. At the very least though, it is reflective as all hell, so much so you can see the light bouncing right off of it. Next is that space gray trackpad, which looks very nice. This I definitely will use. I'll probably pair it with Logitech Performance MX or something like that. Last but not least, we have a black lightning cable. I'm not sure why this excites me, because I know you can pick up a black lightning cable on Amazon, but it is still cool nonetheless. Update, I was looking for some black Apple stickers. Thought there would be maybe a hidden compartment here or somewhere inside, but sadly we are out of luck. So now finally, it is time to get to the iMac Pro. I can see the space gray. Now if you've ever unboxed an iMac, from what I can remember, it's always been styrofoam. So this, nope. That's kind of different, kind of nice. So we got one more box before we get to that iMac Pro, and nothing exciting here. We got that black power cord. Last but not least, we got the iMac Pro. They even got the space gray wrapping around that. Oh my goodness, it looks so good. Plastic off. But I've wanted, I think along with many people, out there for a while now, a space gray iMac. And the fact that it is a space gray iMac and an iMac Pro, it's kind of awesome. Last one. Look at that. Space gray. Holy crap, I feel like I'm sweating getting that thing out of the box. The plan is to use it over the next couple days, test it, edit with it. Tonight I just wanted to get it out of the box so I can get an early start tomorrow and set it up. So that next day has kind of turned into about a week and a half, but within that time, I've got a chance to extensively test out the iMac Pro. To quickly recap and reflect on my thoughts on this configuration, which is a 10-core AMD Vega 64 model, 128 gigabytes of RAM and 2 terabytes of flash storage, I think the sweet spot in terms of price to performance will be taking that base model and solely upgrading the processor to 10 cores. Now the reason behind that is, yeah, those 14 and 18 core machines, they're gonna be monsters, but they're much more expensive, and in terms of the 10 core, that's actually the fastest clock speed you're gonna get in terms of single threaded performance. Now as far as that performance, I actually did a live stream this week showcasing performance and comparing the iMac Pro versus a maxed out 2017 iMac and finally a MacBook Pro. It was more so a real-time kind of benchmark archive, so you can go back and watch that if you wanted to, so I will drop a link down below. In terms of single core performance, they were all pretty close across the board, which really wasn't too much of a surprise. The iMac and MacBook Pro, those were close with multi-core scores. Where the big difference was though, was with the iMac Pro, those 10 cores pumped out a score of over 36,000. Now from there, in terms of disk speed, I kind of assumed all these would also perform very similarly. It was mostly true, except where the big standout was on the iMac Pro, the write speeds were nearly 3 gigabytes a second, which is kind of crazy. So yeah, benchmarks, those are cool, but to kind of showcase some real world examples, for me, I shoot video, I edit video, that is what I do for a living, so my main use for this iMac Pro is Final Cut Pro 10 and editing video. With that said though, I realize not everyone edits video, especially within Final Cut Pro, so I got a chance to sync up with my buddy Matt Workman, who is an insanely smart and talented dude. He was awesome enough to tweak a Cinema 4D scene so I could render it across the iMac Pro, the iMac, and the MacBook Pro. And what's interesting is he actually tested this out on his system, which is a 16-core AMD Threadripper. Configured total cost on that machine is about $5,400, so that kind of puts some perspective on the iMac Pro that it's not crazy, because with that configuration, you gotta remember you're also not getting a 5K display. Regardless though, his system is an absolute monster, and to render out that scene, which is purely CPU-based, no GPU, it took about 3 minutes and 18 seconds on his machine. The iMac Pro was just over 5 minutes. The iMac non-Pro was about 12 minutes, and the MacBook Pro finally finished up at 22 minutes. So you can kind of see the performance across all these systems. Now for reference, I do shoot on an 8K RED camera, but prior to the iMac Pro, for the most part, I would shoot in 4K ProRes. So what that does, it takes that beautiful 8K sensor, kind of downsamples it into a buttery smooth 4K ProRes, which is amazingly fast to edit. You do lose those raw controls, but you get a super sharp image, great color, and more importantly, an insanely smooth editing experience. Now yeah, you definitely could edit 8K RAW footage on an iMac, or even if you wanted to, a MacBook Pro, but it's not the smoothest experience, and rendering and export takes absolutely forever. But on the iMac Pro, it was almost like you unlocked this completely new level of editing. 8K RAW on the iMac Pro kind of felt like I was editing 4K ProRes on a MacBook Pro, and if that makes sense, it's crazy. For me, what was the most impressive thing about this was taking that 8K footage. I shot at a 12:1 compression, which is actually pretty demanding on a computer. And then from there, taking that footage, put it into a timeline, playing everything back, and while that is happening, tweak the raw controls, ISO, white balance. It is kind of mind-blowing. If you caught the live stream, essentially what I had going on was 8K footage dropped into a 4K timeline. I turned background rendering off to kind of make this a little harder on the iMac Pro, but it took that 8K footage in that 4K timeline, then transcoded it into H.264. Unrendered, the total time was about just over 5 minutes for a 3-minute timeline, which is bonkers. From there, while the MacBook Pro and the iMac were still painfully chugging along, I turned background rendering on, exported again, and that was about a minute and 40 seconds, which is faster than real time. So that kind of power has enabled me to take full advantage of 8K RAW, RED's new IPP2 color science, which has been incredible. Within Final Cut Pro 10.4, the new color controls are amazing. There's built-in LUTs, so you can see here, this is pure RED RAW footage. The next step from there would be to apply a Rec. 709 LUT. That kind of gives us a great starting point. And then from there, I can then tweak things to really fine-tune and dial everything out so you can see before and after. So that's kind of been my impressions with the iMac Pro so far. I definitely want to do some more extensive testing and kind of complete these tests on the iMac Pro and the MacBook Pro and kind of do maybe a little more realistic tests. This was kind of an extreme example to showcase the pure power on the iMac Pro. So as I continue to test this, definitely let me know what you want to see in the full blown out crazy review. Aside from that, thank you guys very much for watching. Hopefully enjoyed it. If you did, make sure you smash that like button. If you missed the live stream, which kind of showcases these benchmarks in real time, I'll drop a link down below. This is Jonathan, and I will catch you guys later.